नमस्कार, वेलकम टू वीमेन्स स्पेशल एक्सप्रेस शो। आर टुडेज गेस्ट इज मार्केटिंग एंड कम्युनिकेशन ब्रेन बिहाइंड मेनी स्मॉलर एंड लार्जर ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस। शी ऑलवेज स्टैंड आउट बेस्ट विथ हर पॉजिटिव अप्रोच एंड प्रोवाइडिंग अ वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग बेस टू ऑल द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन शी हैज लेड। शी ब्रोक ऑल द बैरियर्स एट एवरी स्टेप ऑफ हर लाइफ। शी इज अ मार्केटियर थ्रू हर एक्सपीरियंस। शी लेफ्ट हर बिग फैट सैलरी जॉब to make all small dreams big. She has taken many concepts to startup and startup to bigger organization level. She is a founder of a bus company and supporting Creative Bharat initiative. She has won multiple awards, but a noticeable one is Women CMO of the Year 2016 from India Women Empowerment and Leadership Summit. Let's meet this strong and astounding Manjula Nair on our show today. Namaskar. Welcome to Women's Special Express Show. Our today's guest is from marketing field. She is a founder of a bus company, which is a Google certified partner in digital marketing field. She left her handsome perk job to help grow all the small businesses in her country. She has always tried something new in her field by breaking all the barriers. She has also formally revived many awards, standing out her leadership. However, the most brilliant award to stand out is a Women CEO of Year 2016 from India Women Empowerment and Leadership Summit 1. Let me meet this brilliant star, Manjula Nair, on our show today. Namaste, Manjula.
Thank you so much for having me on this show. I'm privileged to be here. Thank you so much for
having me. Privileged to have you, actually.
Thank you.
So, how's this whole quarantine, COVID-19 situation keeping you?
The situation is keeping us quite okay. We got into a self-isolation or self-lockdown at the, I think the Holi day was the only day that I stepped out of home. After that, I have not walked out of home. So, it's been early stage of March onwards is when we are in the lockdown. It's not really impacted much because I am a person who has always loved home. You know, even when I was working, I was very domesticated by my heart. So for me, it's an opportunity to be at home. I have been working for like 24 plus years now. And, I have not really scheduled or taken really time out for myself in my whole journey of professional life, where I would say that, okay, I'm just going to sit at home now for a few days and not do anything. So I think for me, it is more like a universal calling. I have attracted it. It's law of attraction that I'm sitting at home.
So. But you're very busy at work, right? Even now, considering you are into the digital marketing field and you have so many startups, you are supporting so many. So you're very busy, it seems.
Yeah, so being at home is a very big advantage. Secondly, working from home became a very big advantage for me because before I had a company in a particular location in Pune, and I used to attract talent who would be willing to come to office every day, who are living close by and don't want to be stuck in traffic and things like that. Today, with this work from home, where my company model is completely moved to work from home, today I have people working from JNK, I have people working from Punjab, I have my web team based out of West Bengal, I have a team in Hyderabad, Bangalore, and the rest of the team in Pune, all working from home. So it's an advantage to be working from home for a company like mine, because we can attract the right talent. We have more pool of talent now. And I think for me, I'm going to move into this model where, I may have some functions which will work from company premises, but majorly I will have more talented functions which will be working in the remote environment in the near future also. So lockdown actually taught me how to run a company remotely as well. So. Yeah. It's an advantage. Yeah, we are busy, suddenly because of lockdown, a lot of digital stuff is happening around. So we have been getting a lot of calls from prospect clients, from our existing clients wanting to do something more innovative on digital platform. We've become very busy. Public relation has taken up off very well. A lot of media activities we are doing, for startups and SMEs is picked up very well. Before lockdown, people did not want to invest so much in media management. After lockdown, people have realized, media is the one which is going to be doing the talking for us now. So a lot of PR work has started coming our way. So it's been good. I mean, negative thing is COVID-19, but positive thing is lockdown, I feel.
So what's the most challenging part when it came to the digital marketing? Because now everyone is becoming social media partner. They have their own strategies. So what is that most important thing that stands out from most other marketing firms, I would say?
So we are a company which doesn't work as a digital marketing a vendor for our clients. We work more as marketing and communication strategists and then implementers. That means we are in some way working as remote chief marketing officers organization for our clients. So our approach is very different. We don't wait for the client to tell us what needs to be done in marketing. We take on that position and we go and tell the client, this is what we need to do. This should be the go-to-market strategy for us, or this needs to be the communication plan for us. This is what we need to talk about in our press releases. So we lead it for our clients. So the biggest challenge for the startup community or SME community I have seen, which we are able to handle, but there's a challenge there, is that they do not understand the difference between hiring a digital marketing vendor versus actually bringing on marketing and communication strategists. So when strategists come, at least they have a good plan of action for you, which can be implemented by a digital marketing team or a vendor. But if a digital marketing vendor alone comes in, then sometimes they do lack how to build a strategy for go-to-market. What is it that I need to talk on my social media platforms regularly to attract more followers? Or what kind of videos do I keep creating for my YouTube channel? Or even LinkedIn, a lot of founders and co-founders, they are very active on LinkedIn, but what are they active with is basically they're liking and commenting other people's posts, but they are not focusing more on, I need to keep writing and there needs to be consistency of writing authored articles on my LinkedIn channel to show myself as a thought leader in the space that I am in. So these are challenges which are there for the startup. So in some way, the model I have, which is more like a 360 degree marketing and communication package we give you with leadership, that means you're also getting CMO, chief marketing officer, and all the functions which are under a marketing function come to you in a bundle. So that's in a way helping the clients out. So this model is very new. Not many people are doing it because CMO roles were not something people were wanting to outsource in the past. But today people have opened up for that. Just like, finance outsourcing has started taking a boom. A lot of companies have come out for financial outsourcing. HR outsourcing has started. So similarly, marketing outsourcing has also started to be there, but we need to have more and more effective companies who can do this for the startup community.
Yeah, when you said about the initiative and you left a very luxurious jobs, 2 decades you were working and you were placed at a very high positions. You were really handling bigger regions, not just for the country specific, but for the continent specifics. And how did you arrive at a conclusion, that now I'll just stop everything and we'll focus here and we'll help startups or small businesses for that matter?
You're right.
How did this journey initiated?
So, I think it happens in everybody's life. While we are very busy chasing our dreams of professional growth and we want to reach to a certain position, sometimes, we do want to do a lot of things and we keep parking them for, one day I'm going to do it, one day I'm going to do it, right? So, we keep waiting that one day will come someday. So I think for me, it came, I realized that one day has come. I had completed 20 years of professional journey. And that's when I actually sat and I, thought to myself, what should be next for me? I have led marketing functions for companies. I have been somebody who has also in a way mentored and guided my own CEO what needs to be talked about when we are doing a press conference and how to deal with media and how to manage things and all that stuff. So somewhere I felt, okay, now I'm kind of my whole creativity is kind of hitting a blank wall. I've done it for larger companies. I love doing what I'm doing. What's there beyond this? So then I thought about it and I thought that, there are these companies who cannot afford talented marketing resources. They are basically the whole founders and co-founders themselves doing it, whereas they are very great in technology. They're building great technologies and they're building great applications and stuff like that. But somewhere they lack or even they don't have the resources and the money to actually invest in the rightful marketing which needs to happen. And marketing is the backbone for anything. I mean, you may have a great technology, but if you don't have a good plan for taking it to the market, then it fails, right? And then after a few years you see some big brand coming up with similar technology as yours, and then you feel bad that I wish people had known about me. Probably we would have been bought out by this larger company and things like that. So that was the time. It was 2014 when we had PM Modi got elected at that point of time. I really liked his speech on Make in India. I think his first independent speech. I found that if somebody, and it was a very powerful vision that he took out at that point of time, and I think a lot of people agree with me that time that the power that he showed on Make in India initiative and that whole campaign which was driven, we all did get carried away, right? I mean, I definitely got carried away by that. I felt that if somebody has the vision of bringing or making India stand out in global landscape, then people like us who have enough experience in the industry should somehow contribute to this particular community. And startup was something which was very talked about at that point of time. A startup wave was coming out internationally. I think in US, Silicon Valley, a whole lot of Indian startups were already, Indian people running startups was already happening. And then they were now moving back to India and, coming into the startup environment. So I felt that was the right time for me to spin off. There were challenges, there was this, a very little of insecurity that I will not be earning as much as, I've been earning in a corporate job today, leading marketing and communication position. I may not get to travel a lot because when you're funding your own company, you're saving up a lot of cost and all that, because I used to love traveling in my jobs. But then I thought, sometimes you have to lose something to get something in life, and you've had enough of it. It's not like, I did not travel enough or, I did not make enough money. I did, 20 years of my career with smart investments, I have been able to be in a better position financially, independently, of just me, if I'm just talking about me. So for me, that was the thing. So first thing first that I did when I was leaving my corporate job and getting into entrepreneur journey, the first thing which I did was I got away with all the liabilities I had on me. So I stopped using a credit card. I paid off all my loans. Okay, no liability. I paid off all my loans. I planned them well that, you know, my provident fund will help me pay off, you know, whatever liabilities I have. You know, I started off my entrepreneur journey with absolutely no liabilities. I do see that, you know, the newer generation wants to do a lot of things. People want to become entrepreneurs and all that, but they come with baggages, you know. They come with baggages of home loans to pay, car loan to pay, personal loans to pay, a lot of things, you know. For me, I felt, no, if I'm going to have baggages, then I'm going to again, you know, want to go back to a corporate job because it's more secure. So for me, the first thing was that, you know, I'm going to clear out all my liabilities and I'm going to be in a free zone, like freedom. I don't owe anybody any money. So if I don't earn, even that's fine because I don't owe any money to anyone. So that planning I did for myself, and from 2014 to 15, that 1 year I did that planning, and 2015 I left my job and I started my entrepreneur journey, and I knew what I was doing in corporate world, but I wanted to do it for a different segment of community now. So
yeah. Wow, that's nice. So in your career as well as like when you have initiated your own company as well, we find or we see that, you know, one thread that you have always broken barriers, whether it was your first job to break into the DNA networks or coming to the technology world as a marketing and communication person or becoming India head to any tech company or continent head. You have always broken the barriers that will come along with a marketing person. How did that happen? Was it an accident or it was planned?
No, it was never planned. So the first barrier which I broke was at the age of 17, when I walked out of my stepmother's house, leaving back everything there, and I decided that I'm going to make a life for myself. So, you know, I don't think it was planned, you know, it was just the time, the situation wanted me to do that. At that point of time, I could not have a proper vision of my future if I was living under the same roof with her, and, you know, I couldn't just see my future there. So I just picked up my bag and, you know, I took the Kinetic Honda that used to be the bike of my time. And I just left home, you know, and I left home with nothing in my hand. You know, I had not completed my pharmacy, which I was studying. I'm not, you know, MBA. I'm a pharmacist by qualification. I did not carry, you know, I never had a backing of any financial help from the family or extended family. So that was the first barrier I broke. And I told myself that, you know, it's not big deal. You know, you can find a way to live, you know, it's not big deal to earn, you know, 2-time food. If you just want to live by the day, it's not difficult to do that. So I, you know, I started doing fashion choreography. I started doing a bit of ramp modeling also, and I was earning. Then, you know, one thing led to another, and then I landed up in the media industry because obviously, you know, fashion industry is somewhere integrated with media industry. So my first job was also where one of the CEO of a very large advertising agency, he came to attend my event, which was choreographed by me. And he gave me his business card and he said that, come and meet me. You know, probably I have something for you. So that is where my professional journey got started. So that was the first barrier I broke. The second barrier I think I broke was, you know, walking into this event management company. You know, I grew up in Bangalore, and Bangalore used to have a lot of international concerts happening those days. And there was only one company which used to do that. And, you know, obviously I was young and, you know, I was from that industry. I also wanted to, you know, be part of, you know, the Bryan Adams show and, you know, Michael Learns to Rock and you know, all these bands of our time. So I walked into his office and I told him that, you know, I think you should hire me. And he said that we don't hire girls because they come with a lot of baggage and, you know, they have strings attached. We have to always, the concerts go on late and backstage work goes on even later, right? So we would end any concert at 3 a.m. in the morning. Like, you know, that's the time wrap up would happen and all that. So he said, you know, then the parents keep chasing us that where's our girl and all that stuff. So we don't hire girls. So I said, okay, here in my case, you will have nobody chasing you where the girl is because the girl is very independent. Mm-hmm. So I think I was the first girl hired by that agency, which used to do concerts. And then from there, my proper strategy job actually got picked up from there. So there were a lot of, you know, excitement in between. In between, I got to work on a Hollywood movie as a production manager. So I took a sabbatical from this company. I went, worked on the Hollywood movie. And then I came back, I joined them back. And then from there, a bit of visibility increased for me. The industry started seeing that, yeah, there is somebody who's shining in this industry. So then I got my big break, which happened was with Ogilvy and Mather, which is an advertising agency, the number one advertising agency. Mm. There I spent a lot of time and I really learned a lot. And that's where actually I learned more about brands and actual marketing, you know, how do you strategize for selling a particular product. So from there onwards, you know, one thing led to another. And yeah, barriers have been broken a lot.
So even when you did the as a production manager in the Hollywood industry for that film, you also had an offer from that the whole team, right? Saying that, why don't you work for us and we'll sponsor your education for one or two semesters and then you continue here. How come, you know, you said no to that offer and, you know, you joined back where you were and thinking of something. For sure, there was something that was going on in your mind.
I'm so surprised that you remember these things. I don't know when we discussed them. I mean, they are so close to me. Not too many people know about it, but, you know, so the producer was very happy with my work. And he said that, see, you've made enough money to, come to US and study filmmaking. I got excited about it. I did, I didn't have a passport at that point of time because the whole shooting had happened in India. So I decided that, if this is what the direction of my life is, this is what I will do. So I started planning for it. I gave my TOEFL. I cleared that with good marks, good score and everything, then applied for Temple School of Filmmaking in Texas. Even I got a letter from them saying that, not get into admission formalities and all that stuff. And then I, went back, just calculating on the numbers that, okay, I've made so much money and find the fees is so much and maybe two semester is something that I can fund myself. Obviously, I didn't have a backing of my family. I did not want to go back to my family asking them to help me in any way because when I was out, I was out. When I decided that I'm going to make my life on my own, then it has to be on my own, So I, made all the calculations and then I thought, what will I do in the third semester and the fourth semester and there on, So I remember my mentor, who I really look up to, he was the assistant director of that movie. And he said, a lot of Indian students do that. They work in the campus, they can, teach in the campus. Or they can actually go pick apples and make money for their semesters. So, because I think I was exposed to earning money. Mm-hmm. Even before this movie, I was part of this event management company. I used to walk the ramp and I used to, when you're at a very younger age and you've started earning money, when you've started seeing money is coming into your bank bank account. Mm-hmm. Somewhere you don't want to see yourself in a position where there will be no money.
Right.
You know? Yeah. I mean, if I'm just going to be busy studying and one fine day I look at my bank account and I see, oh, the money's got over, then I somewhere, that's a very personal thing. I know a lot of people do that. I want my children to do that, you know, now that they are growing up to, you know, go to US and study and all that. I want them to do that. But I wasn't very comfortable at that point of time. And I decided that, no, I'm going to stay back in India and I'm going to continue doing what I'm doing. And that was a big opportunity which I lost, you know, which I gave up. You know, I'm sure, I don't know, sometimes I think, you know, where would have life been if I would have actually done that, you know, and maybe somewhere in Hollywood, maybe I would have had my name at the end of the Avengers movies or whatever. You know, you never know, right?
Yeah.
But I don't regret it now. Mm-hmm. After a few years, you know, when I picked up my career in corporate communication, I joined IT industry, and then I started traveling to US, and you know, I would stay in W properties, or you know, like Starwood properties, you know, 5-star hotels and things like that. I would have my managers pick me up from the airport and, you know, give me that much of importance and all. And then I, you know, that's when I felt, yeah, I don't think I regret it. I think whatever I decided in my life was right. You know, whatever path I walked was the right path. So now I don't regret that.
So when we say the name Manjula Nair, the first thing that was the Satyam crisis. That was a time you had joined Satyam, and it was just in a month, I think, the crisis happened. And then your name shined, because you kind of branded Satyam in a very positive way, so that the tech-em could, you know, adopt it and, you know, make it further. So looking at that, what I see, you always had a positive strategy in mind, and you always stick to a positive strategies to, you know, market anything. So nowadays we see the marketing also happens in the negative way, so that, you know, something gets value, and even the negative sales, from that point of view, people do a negative marketing as well, be it a movie ad or, you know, anything that we see. Why do you always stick with this positive strategies? What's it all behind?
So see, like I said, Pranali, that I have not become a marketeer with my degrees, you know, with the bookish gyan that I learned. I have become a marketeer with the experience that I walked, right? The opportunities which came my way and made me come to becoming this, you know, leading these positions. So for me, I have always felt that, you know, if marketing breaks down for any company, if the communication breaks down, if this function breaks down for a company, then that's the most disastrous thing for any company. Mm-hmm. A technology can slow down. A technology can have, you know, even break down. A technology can also, you know, take some time to restructure itself, whatever. But your marketing and communication strategy has to be something that has to keep going on, so that companies are always there, you know, they are not being forgotten. So you cannot like go back, you know, say that, okay, I'll fix myself and I'll come back again and again, I will shine. No, it has to be a constant thing. So I, you know, for me, that has been a learning in my experience all throughout. I mean, before Satyam, I also worked with, you know, HP. I was, you know, really privileged to be part of the marketing communication team who got to work under Som Mittal, who was the CEO at that point of time. I learned a lot from that man, you know. He was like really a bond leader. Then followed with, you know, Sapient Corporation, where the CEO was Sandeep Dhar, another fantastic leader to work with. And for me, that whole experience taught me that, you know, this is something which, you know, when you say backbone of a company, then the backbone cannot break, you know, or if a backbone gets infected, then you're going to be bedridden, you know. So marketing and communication has to be up You know, even if you have a pain in your hand, or you know, you've broken your you've got a ligament tear on your you know, leg or whatever, but your backbone has to still be strong, right? To, you know, ensure that you get back to shape. So for me, that learning came very early through the experiences, through the people that I worked for. And luckily, I got really great leaders to work for. So that's what happened when Satyam happened, the crisis happened. I was new into the company that time when the Satyam crisis came up. The whole strategy changed to, okay, we have to retain customers, we have to retain employees. If we lose customers and if we lose employees, then nobody will want to buy us, you know. So we need to remain sick. We've been infected now, we need to remain sick, but we cannot die, because a dying company, nobody is going to buy, but a sick company, somebody will buy us out and treat us and we'll again get better. Satyam at that point of time was the fourth largest IT company, you know, so, you know, it was a big thing. So for me, that crisis management was a positive approach. We were on the floor, you know, the leadership team was always on the floor, motivating employees to come to work every day, you know, because obviously, you know, when something, even MTV tickers are talking about you, the newspapers are always talking negative thing about you, it demotivates a lot of people, especially who are working for you, right? So we had to physically be on the floors, motivate them that, see, we are also coming to work. So that's the time even I decided that I will not leave Satyam, you know, even if I have more better opportunities with me, I will not leave this company just because I have an opportunity. And, you know, looking at me, a lot of women, because very few women are in leadership positions in companies, right? So now that I have come here as a leader in this company, it's my time to prove women leadership, right? If I, you know, take on my opportunity, whatever is coming my way, and I don't care for other women in this organization, they are going to get insecure, right? I mean, if they see that a woman from the leadership has quit the job, the rest of them on the floor are going to get demotivated. And, you know, so I decided that, you know, I'm going to stay on till Tech Mahindra, you know, till whoever, at that time we didn't know who's going to come. So till whoever comes to take over the company, you know, we are. It was a challenging time, you know, a lot of, you know, salaries were frozen for leadership, even more, you know, at least people on the floor, you know, like the juniors and the middle level people were still getting paid, but the senior level people were still put in compromising position that you can't quit, but you know, you can't get your salaries as well. So I did sail through that phase of mine. And I think today I feel very proud that, you know, what happened with Satyam and how we kept the company going and how we found the right partner with the help of the government's board of directors like Kiran Karnik, Deepak Parekh, all these people who had come in. I think it was a very, very success story, you know, of India. Of saving a company not to die. I mean, soon after that, I think Lehman Brothers happened in US and it did not succeed that much, right? I mean, they just couldn't, you know, put the company back together. But at least in our case, being such a largely populated country, you know, we were able to still save a company and we got a good partner to buy us out, and which was an Indian partner again, you know, so we didn't even have to go internationally to find a partner to buy us out. So that's a good learning
story, and you know, to put forward for all this marketing that is happening around. And there is so much negative that's going around, like even if we see now, just now there is an incident happened, right, in a couple of weeks back with the movie star, and then there is a huge media talking about this nepotism, and we don't know the facts, but people are raising the voices against that, and there is still a negativity saying that this could be the cause of, you know, having some accidents in the Bollywood industry. So do you connect that nepotism term in the corporate world? You have a very vast experience, and from the leadership point of view, so you are exposed to many things that many on the floors would not get. So have you seen ever that is happening, or you know, or it's just the talent that matters?
So I think nepotism may not exist so much in our industry of IT, or I don't think it would even you know, exist in other professional industries. It exists in the film industry. The reason being that, you know, if I am a doctor and I want my son to be a doctor, he has to study, right? I mean, he has to get that qualification to become a doctor. Similarly, you know, in our IT industry, you have to be an engineer to come there, right? I mean, you have to study hard to be there. So it's not like, you know, I just go recommend my son, you know, make him a, you know, product manager, you know, after his 12th standard. It's not going to work that way, right? So professional industry nepotism doesn't really happen. You know, I don't think it can fit in here. You know, that word doesn't fit in here. Because firstly, larger companies to even mid-sized companies today, even the startups today are using a lot of third-party resources to hire talent for their organization. So even a startup company who may have a lot of members in their family who can contribute to different part of it, at one point of time, they come out and they say that, you know, it's better to hire talent from outside than having family talent inside, right? So it's very different. Yeah, it could be different for maybe, you know, I'm a departmental store owner and, you know, I want my son to take over from there because I have actually taught him how to do the business. You know, after school, he would come sit with me and see how the operations are happening and how. So the traditional businesses are something where you do want your own family members to be the people who would take them over. But at the same time, when it comes to employment, I don't think professional industry nepotism happens. It doesn't happen. Now, it's happened in the film industry. It's happening there is also because, you know, there's no proper qualification required to become an actor. You're talented. You can sing. You can dance. You can act. You know, you can become an actor. The institutes that we have for film institute and all that, they somewhere I feel that you know their vision for bringing out more better talent and ensuring that that talent is adapted in the industry and they move ahead very well, that I think that leadership quality in these institutes are lacking. Because somewhere again, you'll find the same people from the industry leading these organizations. So they need to be more better planned and organized. Then I think, you know, this industry will become an organized industry. I'm saying this because, you know, I worked in a Hollywood environment and I saw how professional they were and how much they would respect you for your talent, what you have, right? And how much they would respect someone else for their talent, you know, in a different field, but, you know, collaborating to make a movie. So I think that needs to improve in this industry, that, you know, it needs to be organized well. It needs to get into a very good organization space. The institutes which are there for educating people to become good actors need to actually elevate themselves. They need to become more premium institutes. Like in engineering, you know, we have premium engineering colleges and then we have the tier two, tier three, you know. So we have to ensure that the same thing happens even in the film industry. I don't know when that will happen. Someone with a good vision really needs to come in there. What happened with Sushant Singh Rajput was really sad. I mean, I was really moved and touched by what had happened to him. I don't wish that that should happen to anyone. People should not be isolated in life. You know, I am been doing a lot of sessions with IT companies nowadays in this lockdown, wherein they want me to just do motivational sessions with employees who are working from home. And the kind of challenges I see in our our environment also, you know, that we used to go to a swanky office, we would meet at the cafeterias, you know, we would, you know, sit, have chai during the chai time, then we would have town halls, then we would have a lot of activities, right? So That is something which is missing out when you're working from home. And that is kind of creating a very isolation for a lot of people. You know, people who are extroverts and who always wanted to be with friends and all now are not able to spend enough time with friends. A lot of people are alone also, you know, because they're not married, they don't have children and family to indulge themselves in. So in those cases, isolation is happening. So for me, what I mentor when I do my sessions more is that, guys, you know, interact more, get into video calls more, you know, keep an agenda for yourself. Think you're sitting in Starbucks. I mean, think Pranali and me are actually sitting in Starbucks right now, sipping coffee and just having a good chat, right? So if this is going to be the way of life, then we need to look at that. So isolation is going to be a big problem. It's not just what happened with Sushant, but it's also going to impact a lot of people, even in our industry, even, you know, in other industries as well, because you need to find ways. We are social animals, you know. We are social animals. Our, you know, Facebooks and Twitters are also called social channels, right? They're called social channels because of a reason that there's emotional content that we display over there. So we are social animals and we like to show emotional content to each other, right? So it's going to be very difficult if you're going to be isolated. So find ways to still be connected to people around you. Find ways to be connected back with your friends, with your clients, with your team, with everyone, you know, with your family members. I mean, there were times when you were so busy with your friends and you did not have time to even pick up your mom's call. Today, you can actually, you know, set up time for her and, you know, keep calling her up and, you know, staying in touch with her. So these are the kind of things that I see. And, you know, I will not say nepotism is the cause for Sushant's death, because jab tak, you know, I trust a lot more on the jurisdiction of our country, you know, till the time it's not proven properly. I don't believe in rumors. So, you know, we just have to, you know, ignore rumors and we have to keep moving on. Now to your question on, you know, negative communication, which is happening, and with his case, it did happen, right? I think today with communication being on thing to the world. So while I say don't be isolated, be communicative, be around, you know, have a very active social media channel for yourself, but at the same time, gauge how you are driving your content on it. What are you writing on it? It should not be something very sensitive to anybody, you know. So you have to be very careful about these things that you write. I mean, people can write a lot of things. You can write motivational quotes every day on your social media channels. You know, you don't have to always go targeting, you know, different people's view. You know, put only your view and try to see that your view is positively put. So that's the piece of advice that I would give. Become, you know, have more communication. Trust what you can, you know, trust. You don't have to always trust whatever is there. A lot of things cannot be real things also on the social media channels and all that stuff. So, you know, be very smart in understanding what you want to follow, what you don't want to follow. And at the same time, you don't become the center point of any controversies, you know.
Yeah. That's important.
Yeah.
So, when it came down to your experience handling these startups, this is a new venture that you have and you are supporting a lot of startups, right? And you are also hosting a lot of events so that, you know, the communities come together and they can incubate well and, you know, and you also find out where you can give them certain offers, you know, so that it stands out best. So in this whole startup or small business scale situations, what is the most challenging part? Because not many of them have budgets to spare. And, you know, when it the moment they hear that somebody is outsourcing something, for the first thing that they jot down is the money. So how do you convince them that marketing, which is such a not measurable tool, should be outsourced and hire the services?
Yeah. So marketing definitely is not measurable tool, but at the same time, some part of marketing can be measured. Like digital marketing still can be measured, you know. We can see what kind of Google Analytic report can talk about, you know, where the traffic is coming to your website, how are you, you know, followed on your social media channel. So it's kind of measurable. Yes, big challenge with startup community, they don't have money for marketing. They never think about money for marketing. Second is a lot of misperception of marketing and sales function, you know. So a lot of startups think marketing is sales. So, you know, if I hire somebody to market, somebody as a marketing manager for my organization, so they are going to sell for me. So we do sell. Okay, we do sell, but we are more of sales enablers. So we are not directly going out and selling. We are basically empowering the sales team of, you know, a company to get the right collaterals to take to the market. So, you know, your website is great. It's a collateral. Your, you know, brochures, your presentations are looking nice. They are collateral. Your case studies are being built every day. You know, every time you're winning a new client, the testimonials are being created, you know, with collaboration with the client and things like that. So they are all collaterals that marketing function is providing to sales so that the sales job becomes easier to sell. So that is the difference between marketing and sales, which a lot of startups were very confused about this function. They always thought marketing means they're going to bring business in. No, marketing means we bring visibility, we will bring you a lot of leads, but the leads conversion has to happen through the sales function only. And we are basically sales enablers. The second way how I explain to startups is that, you know, a sales job is to bring in money into the company. A marketing job is to spend money of the company, you know. So you do have to spend money in doing media management or, you know, running your campaigns, advertisements on online and all that. You have to spend money, right? So marketing falls into that space, you know. We basically spend your money. So so I do a lot of mentoring sessions with startups on, you know, how to drive effective marketing, how to spend wisely, what are the kind of campaigns you need to run. I do that. And the second thing that, you know, we've proactively started doing from since 2015 that the company got set up, we try to do a lot of pro bono work, you know, in our startup community. So we identify and help what all little things that we can do for them to bring them to a position wherein they can now start paying us a small retainer. So we've been very successful in doing that for a lot of startup clients. And how does it help? How does it work out for me is that I pitch to all level of clients. I even pitch to larger companies. And plus we have different things that we are providing. We are providing marketing only consulting, you know, piece where client just needs consulting. You know, there are new products getting launched and they just need the strategies to be built in, but they have the rest of the team in-house to handle. So we work only as consultants to them. Then we have the whole digital marketing piece with us, wherein we are doing the content, writing blogs for them, authored articles and stuff like that. And then we have PR, public relations. So for me, it helps me because there's within marketing, I'm providing a little bit more diverse roles across for different kind of clients. So for me, it's kind of working out. If this doesn't have revenue, then, you know, the other function has enough revenue to support the teams and all that stuff. So that is helping me out. We definitely look at pitching to larger clients, big ticket clients, so that we can do more pro bono work for startup community as well. So, you know, that is the kind of approach that we have. We are very lean. We don't have a very swanky office. We are, you know, working out of, you know, our bungalow, family bungalow. So, you know, it's not like I have a big real estate cost. And now with lockdown and work from home, I think work from home is going to save me more cost, you know. and I can invest more in people then and get more better talent working for me.
Nice. So you always ask other companies to have outsource their marketing part if they don't have that body. What is that one thing that you outsource from, you know, Abrez, from or the Creative Bharat, either of the initiatives?
What do I outsource? I do outsource a lot of things for my company. You know, our finance function is completely outsourced. The accounts team is an outsourced team that we have. Our HR function is outsourced. The recruitment channel is outsourced. So we also believe in outsourcing a lot. And to some extent, I have seen that, you know, sometimes it's kind of butter with a lot of clients of ours. You know, if we are handling marketing consulting for a particular CA firm, we are also got them as our partners to handle our work as well. So, you know, it's like collaboration in the industry, which is happening. Yeah. So we may be doing marketing for them, but they are also doing accounts for us. So, you know, a lot of, I mean, even in smaller companies, you can outsource a lot of things. You can barter a lot of things together, wherein you provide them service and you can get their services from. The other thing with my company is that because we are startup enablers, you know, we are helping startups to really stand out. We do have access to a lot of tools which could be paid for other companies, but because you know, we are part of the pilots of using these tools, that also helps efficiency of my organization. You know, we also have a lot of processes being put in place because of certain process-driven tool that we are you know, doing pilot on and things like that. So it's all about collaboration.
So when it came down to accepting challenges or moving to new roles, is there any role you have declined, saying that I don't want to work at this position or for so and so project or whatever?
Yeah. I have, you know, I've like said no to really good opportunities which people felt that they were great opportunity, great company, good position, good packages. Then why did you decline? I think you know, I'm a very strong person. Like we spoke about my background, you know, I've been a self decision taker from a very young age, and I believe in instinct a lot. So, you know, I have declined a lot of opportunity where I personally felt something from inside and I felt ki nahi, you know, this is not going to work out for me. Aage badhte hain, you know, whatever great it may be, whatever it may be, aage badhte hain, you know, there's more waiting for me. So I have, you know, I don't want to name those companies right now, but yeah, there have been big, big opportunities that I have declined just because I felt that either they were not fit for me or maybe I was also not fit for them. Not a fit for them, you know. So I have done that, yeah.
Interesting. So now that, you know, we talked a lot and we could go on and on maybe, but then there is a limited time show. So we have to move towards the, you know, the end part of the show, which is little cheesily. So we move to the rapid fire round and then we'll come back to you for taking or seeking advice for appropriate fields that you are in. But let's start with the rapid fire round. So I would ask you a question, maybe a one word or a sentence is an answer that I'm looking forward to. So which is easy, marketing your own business or somebody else's?
Somebody else's.
What's the motivation behind your success?
People who come to my life. It's all people, yeah.
Interesting. An ad that changed your life.
An ad that changed my life. I think I love the ads of Amul Butter. So probably each time I see them and I see that they're doing such an effective news jacking, you know, it's a new perspective to my that particular day.
Oh, wow. Which is the most underrated a home style or a small scale business that can be really ramped up through the marketing strategies?
The vegetable vendors in today's time, you know, the nukkad wale dukaan jo वेजिटेबल्स बेचती थी, टुडे दे कैन एक्चुअली बी डिजिटल. They can still be in that particular community, but you know, if they become digital and if we can empower them in some way to come on digital platform today, and I think for a few more years to go, people at home getting good vegetable supplies on their doorstep through easy platform, you know, through easy booking of vegetables and all that, I think that's a very big business in today's time. And second is, yes, the home education business is also something, you know. Tuition teachers can see how they can empower themselves. I have always felt that in our country, the teachers are not so empowered, you know. Even if it's a big school, we still don't find teachers getting paid handsomely. This is a time for the teacher community also to leverage this lockdown and leverage remote teaching strategies for themselves.
What's the best advice that you have received that you always keep in your success formula book?
The best advice that I have received, which I always so this was like way back when I was working for event management company, and I remember that I was very stressed out because of something. I'm very depressed at that point of time, for I don't even remember why and all. And I had this colleague of mine, and he saw that I was really, you know, tensed about something. So he came and he put a post-it on my computer, and that post-it said, "Never take life seriously. Nobody gets out alive anyways." So I still remember that those lines, and I think that's the way we need to live. We have to cherish every moment of our life. There's no point taking tension about what's going to happen in the future, because nobody gets out alive anyways. One fine day, we are all going to go.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So now the very key question that, you know, we always seek an advice through our show. So since you are now, you know, into the startup, scaling them out and all that business, we'd like to have your advice for all the women who are watching our show, and for all the viewers for that matter, who have the concepts but want to move on to the startup and a big business. What is the advice that you would like to give them?
You should just jump in, you know. You should plan it out well. If your gut feeling says that yes, you want to do something, just jump in and do. Only thing one should not do, which I have seen failing very badly in the startup community, is that you wanting to start something only to sell it off tomorrow to make big money. It should not be the approach. You know, if you're passionate about something, try to run that business traditionally, the way our fathers and grandfathers used to run business, you know. Try to keep your liabilities low. Don't have too much of loan on those businesses. You know, whatever you earn, you spend, you know, have that kind of your business traditionally, passionately for some period of time before you start finding partners to buy you out. But in the first year you start a business and you think that, you know, you need a buyer, that is not a great approach. A lot of startups have failed that way. And for me, it is not that women are better than men or men are better than women. I think today everybody with a good mind, you know, who is passionate about starting something on their own and has that gut feeling that yes, it's unique and it can do very well, just jump into it. Just do it.
Wow.
And you can reach me anytime. I will help you out with the strategy and, you know, go to market plans and everything.
Yeah, you can take any concept to any good business. I know that.
Give me anything to sell. Like I was just selling the bhaji wale ka bhaji, you know, some time back. So give me something. Or you give me...
Interesting part is you are also working for one of the European dumpster company, right?
we used to work for them, and it was a very, very interesting journey. You know, when we picked up the project, they were like, you know, we want about 8 or 10 blogs or 12 blogs in a month, And my team, my content team was like, what can we write about dumpers? I mean, they're garbage dumpers. They pick up garbage every day and they go dump it in a particular place. What can we write on them? But we actually wrote great content out of that. We wrote about recycling. We wrote about environment. We wrote about renovations. We wrote, I mean, so, you know, we wrote about cities. You know, we started branding a lot of cities in the blogs and all that stuff. So it was a very, you know, in fact, when I got this project, I was told that, you know, we've had four agencies before you, but they failed to give us the right content. So are you open to taking up this challenge? And I was like, yes, I mean, very much open to taking the challenge. We will find a way to still write about dumpers.
Wow. Thank you for taking out time and coming to our show and, you know, giving a very good strategy advice to our viewers. It means a lot, Manju. So that was our guest who was into the marketing field, but sticking to a very positive side of marketing. And she always believes that the good should stand out. We'll meet such and more personalities on our show. Keep tuning to Women Special Express Show every week. If you'd like to know more about our show and want to get updates regularly, please like and subscribe our channel, Women Special Express Show. Thank you.
I let go of my claim on you. It's a free world. You look down on where you came from. This place to call.